I'm Kara Peters with WUVA in downtown Charlottesville, where residents are suffering from drastic increases in rental prices. This situation stems from limited land for housing developments, which has over time turned into a full-blown affordable housing crisis.
Last June, the Partners for Economic Solutions released a 114-page study concluding Charlottesville's alarming need for over 3,000 more affordable housing units. We spoke with Elaine Poon, a managing attorney for the Charlottesville Office of Legal Aid Justice Center, and City Council candidate Michael Payne on how this housing crisis emerged and the effect that the university has had on Charlottesville residents.
So the university does not provide sufficient housing for their students, and as a result, students actually go off campus and they look for housing very close, probably walking distance from the university. And as a result of that, landlords have seen, I have a market here that will pay a much higher amount of money. And that is pushing out a lot of naturally occurring affordable housing. So people in historically black neighborhoods very close to the university are actually being displaced.
They're moving to Albemarle County or Greene County or Fluvanna, Buckingham. And so they really become detached from the local Charlottesville community.
With the average cost of a unit being close to $1,400 a month, residents are forced to either spend over half of their income on housing or move to neighboring areas. Sharon Bryant, a Charlottesville native, shares her story on moving to Waynesboro after rental units began increasing in Charlottesville years ago.
I was a middle school math teacher and have been teaching math at Albemarle County for a number of years. But the rents were so high over here, I moved to Waynesboro, found a two-bedroom apartment over there for just $500 a month. And that was unheard of over here. You couldn't even find a one-bedroom over here for $500. And this was in 2010. When I moved back here, I would have much rather preferred to have gotten an apartment of my own. But because the rents were so high, I could not afford it.
The issue of zoning and affordable housing is not unprecedented in Charlottesville. In the past, government zoning regulations have been used to segregate the city on the basis of race, prohibiting residents of color from purchasing a home in certain zoned areas.
There were areas that were clearly marked, for example, zoning ordinance that said in Charlottesville, you know, no person of color could buy in this neighborhood. No one could rent in this neighborhood. That was struck down in the Supreme Court, and what they did instead was they would put it just on the house itself. It's called a racial covenant. And so there are whole neighborhoods in Charlottesville where you can actually trace back through the deed records and you will see clear demarcations in the documentation that says, we shall never sell to a person of color.
Community activist and screenwriter Don Gathers talks about the failure for the government to effectively fix the housing crisis and how this affects minority residents.
With the government not doing anything or nearly enough to help with this crisis to the level that they should, it gives the impression, and one has to accept the fact, that minorities, people of color, black and brown people, truly are not welcome or wanted here in this city. That's the impression that's given.
Perhaps the worst example of racial zoning was Vinegar Hill, a historically black community where in 1965, the city of Charlottesville obtained and demolished this community, leaving it vacant for years afterwards.
Vinegar Hill, 1960-65, when the government moved in under the auspices of progression and took over that neighborhood that was black owned. Black businesses were very much thriving in that neighborhood. The residences there were doing very well. And the government in one fell swoop moved in and took over that entire community and then allowed it to sit dormant for 20 years. They did absolutely nothing with that land, that area that they had moved out and forced all of the blacks out of.
With neighborhoods like Vinegar Hill and the racial zoning as a historical component in the housing crisis, President Jim Ryan sees UVA serving as a key player and working towards fixing this issue. With the construction of more on-grounds housing, such as the Bond House on Brandon Avenue, students living on grounds would lessen the pressure on the Charlottesville housing market, while also allowing for a more inclusive student community at the university.
I think UVA can do a lot by building more housing for students that is on campus, on land already owned by UVA. That way, land that could be used for affordable housing for the community isn't used for just student housing.
It's very important that this entire community, whether they've been affected directly by it or not, get out and speak up, make your voices heard.
We're gonna have to keep up the momentum and keep up the pressure, but across the board, conversations that haven't happened before are happening.
Because it doesn't touch you today doesn't mean that it may not tomorrow. And it's just so much more that we as a community can do better and have to do better. We've got to look out for each other. And because if we don't, again, it may be us, it may be our children, it may be our children's children who are directly affected by this somewhere down the line.
The Bond House is set to open its doors for UVA undergrads in fall of 2019, another step towards solving the Charlottesville housing crisis, but certainly much more to be done. I'm Kara Peters with WUVA.